Between the 4th of June and August 1999, the Robert McDougall Art Gallery presented Acts of Enquiry, a survey exhibition of the work of Canterbury sculptor Bing Dawe. Spanning over 20 years of Dawe's practice and including both prints and sculpture, the exhibition explored Dawe's continuing interest in issues of conservation and the human relationship to the landscape.
These works obviously were, I call them loosely, invented archaeologists, and I was looking at the idea of what would happen to a lot of present-day tools seen in an archaeological life. So I called them tools reclaimed. And in this case, this is a large drilling tool which has been made in London, and sails or other forms of energy use could be put onto them. It made to look as if it was a museum piece, so I was trying to get that sense of being a museum.
So that's where the sort of findings came from, these rocks?
Yeah. And over here in this particular piece, again, we had a record player. This is the tone arm of a record player. And again, it's been put into a sort of sense of being a museum piece or an archaeological piece.
And this one relates to the time
that's been
by Waitaki?
Yes. Well, the stones here are from the Waitaki River. And here I've got a tentative connection between the river as being a source of electrical power. The stones haven't come from there. And this long, narrow piece here connected up to there sort of reinforces that sort of tentative connection.
The quality of the wood looks quite aged. I can see that you've rubbed exactly the time that you've rubbed on the
effect. Yeah. So I was making almost like museum pieces, but using modern equipment to do it.
What do you think sort of started
your
idea of looking to the museum?
I think just being by the museum, my studio was right beside the museum, and being quite influenced by the artifacts, and especially the Maori and Norwegian artifacts were there. I like the shapes and things, so I really, that's where it came from, I think. And this piece over here, if you come over here. Again, I was looking at a part of a car. Mm-hmm. So here we have the differential and the car springs and part of the mudguard. And being looking at the future, being a redundant machine, I've added sails to it so it can be reused.
One thing about the later work, which you see quite often, is a sort of a skeletal feel in this one, and
then
we're trying to get that kind of effect of the bones joining
more. Yes, yeah, they do have that. Sure. I think maybe they are a precursor to my interest in the skeletal. And they are very skeletal and the linear quality as well, so that's something that comes through.
So for those ones, you sort of moved into perhaps
a large
work
that we see here. This piece has that relationship of bones and also the linear relationship. There is a few words in between the last piece, the cut up reclaimed, and this one, so it's not such a smooth transition. But this work was about the discussion I had with Rob Hopery over the aluminium smelter debate and about the Port Chalmers. And I was in a dilemma because there was the fact that the aluminium smelter was being built and the environmental impact that was going to have with my interest in aluminium racing science. So I looked at this and come up with this work here where I've integrated parts and details that you see up here of the cycle into this large skeleton. So I took it as an argument, whereas on one side you've got an argument that looks as in favour, so that the burden flows up. And on the other side here, the negative side of the argument, where the burden goes down. And this is a simple portrait of a figure with a burden.
I see that one, you've got where you're flattened out the skull, you've got almost some sections of the skull that have come out of the top there. Do you remember that?
Yeah, that's actually a skull flattened out, and that came to me once when I was working in the studio trying to actually work on this. And Neil Dawson, a sculptor, came up and said, "Look, I've actually got that. I've got a paper cut out of that, so somebody had already done it." So I used that. And that actually symbolises or sort of comes almost mask like, and can now represent the figure as a general sort of way of looking at all things. So that is reused and reused.
Yes, so this is the companion piece that where the look making reference to nuclear warfare and the insubstantiality, I suppose, of protection that umbrella could offer. So this is called umbrella canopy, and then within it you see the figure trying to shelter.
So the nuclear umbrella was the sort of canopy that protected the countries in the nuclear core?
Yeah. Another element I brought into this too, which is the negative and the positive, where the face and mask comes out of the positive, that's beginning to look at that argument again, that the concept of an argument where the negative and the positive of one's own self is seen. So again, this one is a slightly out of chronological order with the next one, which we can go to over here. And this large piece here represents a bird cage type, and cage has been flattened out. And here again is the negative and the positive, and that forms a circular composition which I use later. But within the frame down here, which is a detail, we have a microscope which is embedded in the bird's wing. So the fight here again is with that balance between technology and the environment. And within the microscope is a finer grid, and within that, well, within there is the whole work, but within that there's a microchip. So I was looking at
and you also get that impression with the steel and the wood as well, that they have the nature of technology.
So I used it as a companion piece to this, which is in the conference centre at the moment, which has a whole microscope, and also using elements in the wing, you know, embedded in the wing as well. It was in this small work over here.
So within this piece, which is a bird strung up, if you like, there's a gun embedded in the wing.
And those are some feathers that you found?
Yeah.
Yeah, so coming back to the idea of nuclear warfare, this work here was the large work I did in 84, which I was particularly pleased with, which looked at the theme of cockfighting too. It's an analogy to global warfare. And so here we have the main ring, which forms the fighting ring. And within there, one bird is already poised within the ring. And again, the idea of the grid, which is the sort of reference again to that slice of time. And over here, and you notice here where the bird comes into the again, into the area of action, if you like, it becomes flat, as too does the figure. And this figure is actually pushing the verdict into it, so there's the relationship between the human and the, or the connection between the human and the bird's fibers. Is that, that analogy of all?
And so this particular slice of time was 1984, wasn't it, where there was a lot of conflict and sort of nuclear tension?
Yes.
So it was truly that effect, but the more domestic kind of
period? Yes, yes. So it is so formative. There's something that I've used more and more is that in order to understand the global, I looked at the domestic, which is also true in another work a couple of years later that we can go to now. This piece was done 2 years later and came out of my time in a freezing place where I was watching two girls play table tennis. So again, it was that idea of the domestic. And it is simply a game of table tennis where the figure is begins with playing the opposition, but in actual fact, the figure actually is playing in competition with himself. And it was also to do with the influence that China was having as well in the global warfare.
And then the table tennis
team used to live? Yeah, so there was that connection there. But again, it looked at the idea that that warfare of this magnitude, because it's capable of destroying the planet, that it had to be seen as almost a mammoth type warfare, where not too similar to the medieval warfare, where you select an area like a playing field. And you basically go to it with set rules for life. So it's also sort of playing with those ideas as well. And again, the idea of the negative and the positive, you know, the figure pulls out of themselves almost, so you have that negative and the positive. And also, too, just this other device I used where you can see the circle here overlaid with another circle, which is also shown in the back of the bell, at the back there. The idea that one person has a sort of circle of space and then they interact with another person. And it's that connection there that produces that dynamic, you know, whether it's more fear, whether it's more whatever. A couple of years later, I looked at the idea of the two parts of the person in this room. Still there's a military theme to it. So there's a figure actually doing a commonwealth, which is a military exercise. And in here you see the relationship to the horse. Mm-hmm. It's an exercise aimed at climbing on the horse. But effectively really it's only looking at this pull between the two parts of the of itself, and so the figure peels itself out of itself, and it's within a strict half circular composition. So I've emphasised that by actually taking the lead here and folding it back into the composition. So it was a piece that was really just looking at that one aspect, but still with that connection to the military. This work, firstly, is a simple work, but it was just based and just harking back to some of my the connection with birds and flying and things. Really, was just to do with the idea of faith. And here, the figure takes the mask of the bird and clamps it between his knees and is just leaping out into the void.
Assuming he can fly, because he's
there. Yes. Yeah. But it's just that sort of sense of faith.
It's quite a large work, and I noticed that some of the ones we've been talking about have been very large. Was that something that you did consciously, the work on that scale, or were you making smaller at the same time?
No, it was a scale that was set almost by the figure, so they were human size. But that's the birds themselves were enlarged because they began the idea of the albatross sort of being a big bird, so but they were made to get that sense of largeness. 1960s. We've done it at the same time as I was working on the cockfight, and they were to do with the idea of boundaries. And there were lots of little ideas I had. And I'd started doing printing a couple of years before, and these were just extra ideas I had that I'd run into two dimensions. But they looked graphically, again, at some of those ideas of the boundaries, you know, the circular boundaries that you have around yourself. I was interested in the idea of doing these types of jobs and the way that that mind, where our consciousness goes off the activity we're involved in. And so here, in this repetitive blind spot, I've looked at the idea of a bat that's been hitting the ball backwards and forwards, and where the string of the ball connects up, that's the blind spot, because that doesn't hit. So the ball's in the back, it's hit back and forwards on this thing making these prints. I was quite interested in the idea of trying to create a sort of sense of attraction and repulsion almost within the same figure. And I was thinking back to fairy tales and the sort of sense that you get from those old illustrations. And this work came from there, where I discovered these, what were titled fabulous races, which were really characters that really you're being explored just in the parties. And there were several of this one, playing a man on the face of his chest and fingers with large feet. And I thought, well, rather than try and do anything with it, I just simply try and repeat it. So I carved this figure here. And then as a result of that, well, at the same time, the council so I did a sculpture based on these figures, which received quite a lot of controversy. And the controversy, although I found them quite difficult, was actually very interesting that this is considerable amount of polarisation that was happening. And that's the sort of the issues that I was quite interested in at the time. Noted here, Christine, again, just simply repeating these images of these figures. So there wasn't a huge amount of drag involved. I just picked them up from the model woodcuts and remade them. And here's the man with the face and his chest again. A woman with her feet on the back to front. She was called an anthropod. And the next one here was a figure with a large foot. Yes, so in this work which developed out into the feminist races, and feminist races seem to me to be something of a diversion, but in hindsight now they actually lead me into some quite interesting ideas. But this work here revisited the ideas of conflict, the inner conflict between the two sides of a person. So simply the figure just sort of pulls and distorts his face. And again, you can see in this work the reference back to the masks, these pieces here. So even though I've got flesh on top of it, it's still the idea of a mask, so it can be manipulated. So it's also the idea of manipulating a mask.
And you've got those same qualities you were talking about in the previous ones of the attraction and repulsion, because obviously the face is quite ugly, and he's trying to make himself quite ugly, but the tone on the board and the way you've treated the words is quite beautiful.
Yes, so it's trying to do that, especially influenced by artists like Dawe at the time, who were able to deal with very hard subjects, but you know, still treat them. The canvas, if you like, really beautifully.
At this stage, you've been working with wood for quite a long time. Were you sort of starting to be exploring the medium quite a lot? Exploring the medium of the wood. I mean, the way you've drawn the wood in here is really unusual. Were you starting to sort of...
Yes, well, I still write wood because of the human quality, so my spectators, my audience, if you like, can always associate it, so I can get quite a sense of the spectator knowing the material, knowing the intimacy of it. And you can get a certain feel. The fact that it was carved and unmodeled and things like that, and get a certain impact, that's important. So, I stay with wood for that reason.
I guess that kind of familiarity that you've got transfers into the sort of cabinet pieces when you're looking at quite traditional and familiar shapes as well.
Yes.
So this one was based on a particular experience that you had?
Yes. This was looking at my time fishing, where I've been down on the Waitaki River, and I stepped out of the water and accidentally kicked up these fish out of the water, and went back into the water and discovered that there was a run of lamprey. Well, I thought they were eels at the time, but they're actually lamprey. And I was just wanted to try and to give a sense of repeating that, but also looking at the image, the idea of distorting the relationship between humankind and the natural and the way we almost have to distort ourselves now to see some of those simple things. So the figure sort of sits on the landscape, and these cabinets, as we refer to, represent the earth. They represent the earth as a storage provider of things. The reference to the curve, just as that curve of view. And the figure distorts itself on top of that. So there's that sort of difficult relationship, if you like, between the natural, the earth, and the human figure.
And I was thinking with this one, with the clothes sort of cabinet form, the idea of some sort of treasure or mystery or secret that you get with the kind of mysterious lamprey
as well. Yes. So, and there's also this, the relationship between sort of abundance, the idea of sort of the abundance and sexuality as well, of this huge run of fish. So the figure tries to, by distorting himself, get into the school of fish and kind of swim up with them.
I've extended that theme again, and maybe in a simpler word, again, the figure just simply takes on the body of the fish and swims up. And again, that reference to the earth as a cabinet. And inside the cabinet, in this particular work, is the sense of a storage cupboard, sort of almost like a riches, even though it's not inside, sort of a sense of a riches of the earth to provide.
Yes, this work here looks at the cabinet again, and the eel simply lies across, so the eel is part of catch, the idea of food storage, food stored up for winter, whatever. The eel lies across the landscape, and then within the eel itself, the gut cavity has been opened up, and so we get the cabinet almost repeated again, and just by pressing that there, we can get inside the cabinet.
And I noticed this one's called Eon Berlin's Black Stones. Why take it? What were the black stones that you were talking about there?
The black stones referred to the old cooking stones that they found at the Waitaki River, or they find them because the local farmer, when he ploughs the paddock, when he turns the stones over, these black stones keep reappearing. So they're a link between my sort of history, or my sort of sense of history, and a history that goes way, way back.
Mm-hmm.
So they were quite significant for me in the early years, because it gave me a sense of a history that goes beyond just what my experience was.
And also a sense of that sort of slice of time that you've been living in.
Yeah, that's right. That comes back into it. So here, this work was trying to conjure up quite a lot of just straight feeling as well. This, you know, the cover on it. This right there in the cabinet itself, there's printed stones were printed on it and sort of burnished over top, so sort of hint of stones coming through. And the inside the cabinet is structured, so it looks as if the wood is moving, so you get a sort of sense of moving, you know, these eels migrating out to sea.
This work looks at the idea of the eel trap, and again, the eel trap making reference to the cabinet and the curve of the earth. It was based on a photo I saw of an old marriage with a whole about 20 piles of eels in front of them. And I was interested in some of the issues around the reapportioning of Maori land back to the various tribes. And so I saw this as sort of an analogy towards that apportioning, whereas the guy in the photograph had the eels all portioned out. Here, I've just shown you one portion of it, which represents the issues around that.
This work is looking at the subject of death, but also the same analogies. Here the basket again is a smaller version of the cabinet, so this is the earth. The basket's empty now, and it grabs the skin of the figure and pulls it down. So here I'm saying that the skin and the flesh is just an earthly thing, and you know, maybe it's a return back to some of the skeletal images I was interested in. Again, the figure is pulling the face and grotesque face.
And the flattened out skull is more comfortable with the teeth mask.
Yes,
and
yes.
Was more beautiful.
Yes, yeah. And the cabinet itself, the inside of the cabinet is a reflection of the last.
So when we're talking about the interior of the cabinet, I mean, there is an effect to the way you can see that quite clearly in this one.
Yes, this one I've actually had it put a pictorial image into the cabinet of the eels, or the ghosts of the eels, if you like. And this looks at the Burdens Flat, where they dig channels for the eels to migrate out into, but they're blind channels. And then they pull them. Then these are the Maori community down at Burdens Flat. And then they pull the eels out of the channels. And so in this work you can see the eels coming up into a blind channel. And again, that blind channel is the earth represented by a cabinet, this time on its side.
So this is
the
pretty recent
work? Yeah, this is my final work done this year, Christine, and it looks at the figure who has picked the eel up out of the eel. This is an eel trap, again, almost sort of made almost as if it's an actual trap and been found. And he's pulled the eel out, and it's resting or rolling over the cage, and he's gutted it, and he's actually putting his fingers into the gut of the eel.
So it's almost like that idea of
doubt and tolerance. Yes, that image comes to mind when I was looking at this work, and the whole work is about that, you know, quizzing, you know, where the eels go, you know, why, just the mystery, the idea of the mysteries.